Donald Trump continuing to build up his cabinet. The president-elect says he will nominate Wall Street CEO Howard Lutnick to serve as his commerce secretary. With Lutnick, Trump taps a longtime friend who supports his vision to bring manufacturing jobs back to the U.S. and promote the adoption of cryptocurrency. Lutnick will also be heading the department at the center of the tech war between China and the U.S. Meanwhile, Trump has chosen celebrity doctor Mehmet Oz to serve as administrator for the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. Also known as Dr. Oz, he will be in charge of the federal agency that provides health coverage to more than 160 million Americans, almost half the country's population. Prosecutors who secured Donald Trump's conviction over hush money payments to adult film star Stormy Daniels oppose having the case dismissed now that he is president-elect. Trump had been scheduled to be sentenced on November 26th, but New York State Supreme Court Justice Juan Merchan last week put all proceedings in the case on pause at the request of the Manhattan District Attorney. The prosecutor said they would accept a delay, but asked Merchan to set a deadline for Trump to formally seek dismissal of the case. They also said consideration must be given to deferring all proceedings until after Trump finishes his four-year term. Trump is hoping to start his second term unencumbered by any of the four criminal cases he has faced, and which some opponents had predicted would derail his 2024 candidacy. Ukraine fires U.S.-made long-range missiles into Russian territory for the first time as the war enters its 1,000th day. Russia claims its forces shot down five of six missiles fired at a military facility in the Bryansk region. Ukraine, meanwhile, says it struck an arms depot 110 kilometers inside Russia. In a speech to mark the 1,000th day since Russia's full-scale invasion, Ukraine President Volodymyr Zelensky urged citizens to remain resilient as he touted plans to ramp up the production of weapons and stabilize the front line.
We need the resilience of the entire Ukraine at decisive moments which will come next year. We should prevent anyone in the world from doubting the resilience of our country. At this stage of the war, it is being decided who will prevail, whether us over the enemy, or the enemy over us, Ukrainians and Europeans, and everyone in the world who wants to live freely and not be subject to a dictator.
Now, an agreement to end the conflict between Israel and Hezbollah now within reach. That's according to the U.S. State Department, which says significant progress has been made on a U.S. ceasefire proposal. White House envoy Amos Hochstein is in Beirut on a last-ditch attempt by the outgoing Biden administration to broker a ceasefire in Lebanon.
With the parties, and we can see that we have overcome some of the obstacles to getting a resolution, but there's more to be done. We need an agreement from the parties, but we are working to accomplish that. We want to get one done as soon as possible.
The diplomatic efforts coincide with an intensification of the war, with Israel stepping up strikes on Beirut's Hezbollah-controlled southern suburbs and striking three times in the capital itself in the last 3 days. Lebanese authorities say more than 3,500 people have been killed in Israel's campaign. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. We begin with President-elect Donald Trump confirming in a social media network that he plans to use the U.S. military to carry out mass deportations, a cornerstone of his 2024 campaign.
On Monday, Trump posted "True" in a response to a conservative commentator who wrote that the Republican president-elect would declare a national emergency and use military assets to lead, quote, a mass deportation program. Leading up to the election, Trump repeatedly vowed to deploy the National Guard to aid the Immigration and Customs Enforcement in carrying out deportations. Trump pledged to begin deportations on his first day in office in January. Democratic leaders are already pushing back, threatening to file legal challenges and refusing to cooperate with his deportation agenda. Critics are also doubtful that ICE's 20,000 agents and support personnel from the National Guard would be able to track millions of undocumented immigrants. And then there's the major financial cost. The American Immigration Council estimates that deporting 1 million people a year would cost more than $960 billion over a decade.
Meanwhile, as he is nearing the end of his term, U.S. President Joe Biden has expressed his intent to nominate Filipino-American leader Loida Nicolas Lewis to a key position.
President Joe Biden has announced his intention to nominate Filipino-American leader, businesswoman, and philanthropist Loida Nicolas Lewis to serve as a key leader in his administration. The Bicolana is expected to be nominated as a member of the board of directors of the Millennium Challenge Corporation, or MCC. MCC is a U.S. government agency that provides grants to developing countries that meet certain policy criteria. It's a U.S. foreign aid agency that helps alleviate poverty in the poorest countries worldwide. It was created by the U.S. Congress in January of 2004 with strong bipartisan support. Nicolas Lewis is the CEO of family-owned investment firm TLC Beatrice LLC. Lewis made history as the first Filipino woman to pass the New York bar without attending law school in the U.S. She also won a discrimination case against the U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Service, where she integrated the agency and worked as general attorney in the New York federal office from 1978 to 1988. She's also the co-founder of the National Federation of Filipino American Associations, or NAFA, and U.S. Filipinos for Good Governance.
And a big hello for Catherine Bernardo and Alden Richards as fans gathered at the LA International Airport to greet the box office record-setting love team.
Online news site Deadline reported that their new movie, Hello Love Again, earned $2.4 million during its opening weekend and has climbed to the number 8 spot at the U.S. box office.
And in that future, Joy, you have a home in me.
The ABS-CBN Films and GMA Pictures joint production now holds the record as the biggest Filipino film opening in the U.S.
We're just very excited, you know, that this is our first leg for our international tour for Hello Love Again. And we're just very happy with the performance of the film internationally. And we're just surprised and so very blessed with the achievements that we are able to accomplish with this film. So maraming salamat po.
A jam-packed schedule awaits Bernardo and Richards, who play Joy and Ethan in the film, a sequel to the 2019 blockbuster hit Hello Love Goodbye. They'll meet with American media in the next few days and attend the Asian World Film Festival on Wednesday, where Hello Love Again is the closing night film. The two will also join fans for screenings in Carson City, a hub for the Filipino-American community. And their next stop would be Toronto, Canada.
More than anything, naalis naman lahat ng pagod because of the support we've been getting. So, kayang-kaya.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at the Rundown.